Aujourd'hui, séance du président qui a le privilège de choisir les orateurs. Alors je vous ai fait une surprise, les deux orateurs sont neurochirurgiens. La séance est également particulière puisque nous allons accueillir en fin de matinée nos nouveaux membres élus que nous montrerons, que nous appellerons et qui viendront recevoir leur diplôme ici même. So now, I shall switch to English language because I want to say a few words on our guest. In alphabetic order, Professor Armando Basso. He speaks French. He will deliver his lecture in French, but I speak in English. So both Professor Basso and Professor Alexander Potapov from Moscow will follow what I'm saying. First of all, thank you for coming from very far to be here in Brussels, because I know that you are going back tomorrow to Argentina, and you are going back tonight to Moscow. So it's a very short stay, and you have accepted to come today here, especially for me, and really thank you very much. So I know them since many, many years. I shall not say how many years, otherwise you will think that I am an old man. So I shall keep it confidential. But I know Professor Basso, Professor Konovalov, since many years, because together we have teach all around the world, especially in developing world, giving lectures on all topics of neurosurgery. So we have spent days and days in not comfortable situation always, but always in a very warm environment with young neurosurgeons from poor countries, and this is a part of our life. The first speaker will be Professor vous pouvez vous asseoir, M. Blanc-Père, discrètement, comme ça. C'est votre entrée à l'Académie est passée inaperçue. Professor Potapov, Alexander Potapov, is now director of the Burdenko Institute in Moscow. Burdenko Institute in Moscow is the oldest institute of neurosurgery, the most famous, the most well-known, and the highest neurosurgeon from Russia and in the past from Soviet Union have been the leader in that institute. And even some president of Russia who had problems came to be operated. I shall not give the name who came and have been operated in Burdenko Institute by Professor Potapov. So he is really a giant in neurosurgery and director of an institute which also has been very famous many years ago because of the name of the pioneer of interventional neuroradiology, Professor Serbinenko. Serbinenko was working there. He was the first to enter the carotid artery and to detach a balloon in order to make some embolization. Many people came to watch how he was doing. He was very open to everybody, but he did not explain to nobody how he was doing. So the people were coming, watching, and living without understanding how could he do it. But he did it, and he was the first to do that in the same institute as Professor Potapov. He is also very important is a full member of the Russian Academy of Science. You know, the Academy of Science is something very, very high in Russia. He is, of course, foreign member of our academy too, which is also very important. And he has been training in Russia, but also in Karolinska. And we are here to listen his experience, especially in neurotraumatology, because he has a fantastic experience on that topic. At the time, I was president of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. I have asked him to chair the Neurotraumatology Committee because he is really an expert in that field. He is a member of many societies. He has received many decorations. And one is very important for me. It's the Medal for Labor Heroism and the State Prize of Russia and many, many other orders. So now I think it's time to listen to your lecture. And the title of the lecture is Basic and Applied Aspect of Traumatic Brain Injury. Sasha, to you.
This could have been in my pocket. Oh. This one. Mr. President, dear colleagues, dear academicians, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank Professor Jack Brochi, the full academician of Russian Academy of Medical Science and the honorary professor of the Burdenko Neurosurgery Institute for kindly invitation me here to this prestige academy to be as a speaker. It is a great honor for me and pleasure indeed, and thank you very much again. This picture shows our institution, and you see the different buildings where is located the institute. It is one of the oldest building during the Second War. It was a hospital for the head injured people. They were transported just from the front, and during the Second War in this building, in other old building, it was operated more than 100,000 cases during the Second War. The later on, one new building now is rehabilitation block, and later on we have a new neurosurgical building. There are 15 operation theaters and the big neurointensive care for 40 beds, and we have here 10 clinical neurosurgical departments. And this is one of the part of the old building during the Second War. In this church and in this building was the operation theater. And now in the basement of this square, we have some radiosurgical department with a cyber knife, gamma knife, LINAC, and so on. And let me show our surgical activity. During the 40 years, my teacher, world-famous neurosurgeon, Professor Konovalov, was the director of our institute, and you see how increased our activity during last two decades. Today, we operate more than 9,000 surgeries, including 2,000 of radiosurgical case. And my talk is today about the neurotrauma. There are, every year, over 20 million people get neurotrauma, and only over 1.5 million of them die because the natural te- technological, conflict-related, and combination of different types of disasters. In my report, I would like to highlight the following issues: epidemiology, concept of primary and secondary brain injuries, CT and MRI study, and so on. More than 20 years ago, I took part in medical care after three big natural and technological disasters on the territory of the previous Soviet Union. This table shows that the percentage of the hospitalized and percentage of neurotrauma depend on type of disaster. You see, after explosion of the trotyl in Arzamas, it's one of the center, nuclear center of Russia, in the middle of Russia, you see the percentage of neurotrauma was 50%. After a quake in Armenia, the 20% of all injured people had neurotrauma. After gas explosion in Bashkiria, it was 77%. Let me show the typical crushing of the head because the destruction of the building during the earthquake in Armenia. How complex injury is. And we describe these cases like a crushing of the head after long-term crushing of the head of the child. And you see some steps of treatment, removal of necrotic tissue, some replacement of the skin, and the 1 year after treatment. It was done 25 years ago. And now, today, traffic accidents are the main cause of severe head injury, according to the Ministry of Internal Affairs. And in Russia, in 2005, we had more than 33,000 traffic fatalities and about 300 cases non-fatal injuries. And now we have 27,000 road traffic fatality, a little bit less, but it's a serious problem till now. And when I analyzed the literature before coming here, I seen the paper that in Europe, the overall incident rate of 242 per 100,000 for admitted TBI was derived. And falls and traffic accidents were the two most frequent causes of traumatic brain injury. And this picture shows a modern trend in BRIC countries. You see, in Brazil, it's real tendency to increase. In Russia, some decreased tendency. In India, increasing tendency. And in China, some decrease. But World Health Organization predicts rank rise of road traffic injury as the leading cause of death by 2030 in all aging groups. Let me say some words about the modern concept. Today, according to this concept, we can divide the TBI into primary and secondary cerebral damage due to its different mechanism. You see, there are different mechanisms which is the reason for the primary diffuse, focal contusion, laceration, focal plus diffuse, crushing injury. And this primary injury damage initiate a cascade of secondary brain damage, hemorrhage, swelling, edema, ischemia or hyperemia, hydrocephalus, increased ICD, herniation, and so on. In the last few decades, the implementation of computerized tomography has dramatically improved identification of primary and secondary brain lesions, skull fractures, understanding pathogenesis, refined treatment modalities, and brain trauma outcome. It should be stressed that today, computerized CT is a technique of choice for initial evaluation of the traumatic brain disease. A widespread use of CT led to development of CT classification, clinical CT-based prognostic models, classification of TBI for target therapy, which was performed by Tom Generelli, Laurie Marshall, Andrew Mass, and others. After implementation of MRI, some series of studies were done to compare the effectiveness of CT and MRI in patients with TBI. You see, this patient was in comatose state, but practically it was a normal CT when we performed the 5 days after injury, the MRI, we could see the injury of the corpus callosum. It was a sign of non-hemorrhagic diffuse injury of the brain. MRI is more sensitive for detection also parenchymal non-hemorrhagic lesions and microhemorrhagic lesions, and visualization of the posterior fossa structures, including the brainstem, in acute, subacute, and chronic phase. Let me show the another picture. You see the how different is picture if you use routine modalities and new modalities with more sensitive possibilities. It's another case, you see absolutely normal CT when we use the modern SWAN modality, you see how many microhemorrhagic injuries the patient has. And it is the real causes of the severity of the condition of the patient. Another case, this is a pilot of aircraft, and he got a trauma at the airport. And you see, he was admitted in subacute phase to our institution, and he had some swelling of the brain with focal contusion. But when we performed the MRI, we could see the subacute hematoma, and it shows us that MRI is much more sensitive, not only in acute phase, but in subacute and chronic phase. And I agree with Andrew Mass and Kavoka, a paper which was published this year in Neurosurgery, that current classification of traumatic brain injury based on CT data is suboptimal, and management is based on weak evidence with little attempt to personalize treatment. Some years ago, MRI classification of severe head injury were proposed in series of studies by Fishing, Menon, and others. However, in these studies, the prognostic value of MRI data was evaluated without considering the involvement of the deep hemispheric structures, and they used routine MRI modalities. Thus, we can stress that new neuroimaging modalities are more sensitive in detecting small lesions in acute, subacute, and chronic stage. And you see here the same picture. The patient is in comatose state, 5 on Glasgow Coma Score, and he is 90 years old after traffic accident, then practically normal CT with some a little bit swelling, and when we perform the new modalities, you could see multiple microhemorrhagic in different deep structure, salamis, subcortical area, in brain stem injuries, and so on. And the main question is how to classify this many diffuse multifocal injury. And to answer this question, we analyzed 212 patients with acute TBI who underwent MRI. And the main characteristic of this group are shown on this slide. 86% of these patients had traffic injury you see here, and 60 of them had a severe head injury. And let me show the results of this study. This slide demonstrates that traffic mechanism produces significantly more often damage to corpus callosum, subcortical, and brainstem structures compared to non-traffic mechanism, which mostly leads to superficial cortical damage. You see in the group of patients after traffic injury and another one after non-traffic falling, assault, and so on. Patients in traumatic coma have a specific neuroanatomical pattern, which is quite different from non-comatose patients. This paradigm supports the hypothesis proposed and published by Omaya and Tom Generelli more than 40 years ago. And you see what is the difference between the patient who was admitted in comatose state and in non-comatose state. And let me compare this group of patients according to the Glasgow outcomes score. We use the unfavorable outcome and favorable outcome evaluation. And you see the involvement of deep brain structure increase the chance of the unfavorable outcome. This data permit us to arrange the new MRI grading scale on brain damage based on detailed evaluation of superficial and deep hemispheric brainstem lesion. And you see in group of patients who had only cortical, subcortical contusion, the percentage of patient in comatose state was 36, and the patient who was some signs of corpus callosum, the percentage of comatose patient was 64, and the basal ganglia the same percentage. But when the patient had a involvement of the brainstem, you see how increased the percentage of patient in comatose state and how increased the unfavorable outcome. And we have found a strong correlation between the proposed MRI grading scale and Glasgow Coma score. You see here the result of this statistical analysis. And the same picture when we perform the Glasgow outcome scale and a correlation with our grading scale. Adding some clinical data to MRI grading scale just slightly improves the accuracy of prediction of up to 90%. A logistic regression was performed to evaluate the most important predictors for poor prognosis. It turned out that the brainstem damage, as well as salami and basal ganglia damage, are the main prognostically significant factors, and brainstem damage seems to be the strongest. According to our data, such factors as basal ganglia, corpus callosum damage, brain displacement, and comatose state increase the risk of unfavorable outcome up to 8 times. A damage to thalamus, in addition to brainstem damage, significantly increase the chance of unfavorable outcome 40 times. In this slide, you can see that patients with compression of the mesencephalic cistern have a higher rate of unfavorable outcome as compared to patients with a primary brainstem without the compression of the basal cistern. It's well known that, and our data shows that the brainstem injury is not always accompanied by comatose state and does not always lead to unfavorable outcome. This picture shows that the brainstem and thalamus injury rate related to trauma severity evaluated by Glasgow Coma score. And you see this relationship according to our data. In our study, only 2 patients showed medulla oblongata lesion. One of these patients had 11 scores by Glasgow Coma score, tetraparesis, swallowing dysfunction, and dyspnoia. MRI study identified non-hemorrhagic lesion of the basal ganglia, you see here, thalami, and brainstem, and here. And this patient was treated conservative, and we analyzed with good outcome. And we analyzed this patient 6 years after injury. And we could see only small cyst in medulla oblongata, and the patient recovery, and she continued to work as a nurse. Let me show the another observation of patient, 28 years old. She suffered also a car accident. She was in comatose state, 8 on Glasgow coma score, but she had bilateral mydriasis without photoreaction. It means very deep coma, but it is what not so. When we perform the CT, you could see only small hemorrhage and pneumocephaly on the skull base. That means that the patient had the skull fracture. When we perform the MRI, we could see the focal injury of the brainstem. We perform the all possibility neuromonitoring and so on. And 15 days after trauma, the patient was consciousness, recovery, full, but till that time she has bilateral mydriasis without photoreaction. And you see this is a control MRI with small lesion in brainstem. In 3 months after injury, outcome was moderate disability, and in conclusion, we could say that brainstem lesion do not always lead to unfavorable outcome in case of the very small, mostly microhemorrhagic or non-hemorrhagic injury. Some words about diffuse axonal injury. Diffuse axonal injury remains a prominent type of TBI, mostly after blast injury, terroristic attack, traffic accident, and is characterized by axonal disruption and retraction into balls, as it was revealed by special morphological studies by Strich, Adams, Pavlyuchuk, Professor Kasumova from our institute. And you see, it is axon. It's the place of the injury of axon. And this axon, axonal leakage, and we call it axonal ball. Before MRI, it was possible only to see by post-mortem morphological study. But now, using the MRI study, we could see this kind of injury in the different structures of the brain, in brainstem, in corpus callosum, in basal ganglia, salama, and so on. And let me show the one case. It was a Russian general. He was 47 years old. He got a blast injury after terroristic attack during the Chechen conflict in the south part of Russia. He was in deep coma, 4 on Glasgow coma score, and you see he had multiple hemorrhagic injury, subarachnoid hemorrhage, focal injuries in deep structure in different places. It was 20 years ago we performed the MRI. We have seen the same location of injury. In 19 years, now he is in minimal consciousness state with tetraparesis. And let me show the 2012 traffic accident. Young man, 22 years old, Glasgow coma score 4. He has the same diffuse axonal injury with small hemorrhages in different structure. It is this one regime, SWN, which permit to see all hemorrhagic injury. In 2 years after injury, he was in comatose, in minimal consciousness state with tetraparesis. Let me see him in two years after diffuse axonal injury. Diffuse atrophy of the brain. You see the mapping of the fractional anisotropy. You see the picture of the corpus callosum, and you see the patient. And let me see the another patient who was injured 20 years ago. Now it was 1995. Till now, he is in minimal consciousness state with diffuse atrophy of the brainstem, hemispheres, and so on. He was in vegetative state during 3 months. I invited Professor Tsubakawa from Tokyo University, and we introduced the stimulation to the spinal cord by stimulation the spinal cord, and he went from the vegetative state to minimally consciousness state, no more, and he is alive during this 20 years old. Now is clear that diffusion imaging is a high sensitive method of diffuse axonal injury diagnosis to see the real human connectome. You see how it look our corpus callosum with ascending fibers, and it is our cortical spinal tract. And it is our data which shows a comparison of average fractional anisotropy values. It's an indicator of the integrity of the fibers. And you see, it is our normal corpus callosum. You see, it's after diffuse axonal injury. Between two picture is a big difference, like between these two cats. And this is our normal cortical spinal tract. There is a cortex, and there is a posterior limb of internal capsule, midbrain, pons, and it's one of the biggest axon in the, our body. And you see, when the patient has a local injury of the cortical spinal tract, we see the asymmetry of the fibers and asymmetry of fractional anisotropy in patient with hemiparesis. And fractional anisotropy is an indicator of integrity of the tracts in cortical spinal tract, in corpus callosum, in acute, subacute, and chronic phase, where prognostically significant due to their correlation with Glasgow outcome score. Some was about dynamic study of severe diffuse axonal injury. You see, another case of patient who had the same injury of brainstem, corpus callosum, 4 days, 30 days, 4 months, nothing interesting, maybe a little atrophy. But when we perform the tractography, you see that the axonal injury is a trigger of the degenerative process. You see how decrease the number of fibers in different structures, asymmetry of the cortical spinal tracts, and the patient in 4 months was in severe disability with tetraparesis, one side hemiplegia. Another case, hemorrhagic injury. You see, practically normal corpus callosum in the first day after trauma, some asymmetry of tracts, but later on, in 2 years, the total atrophy of corpus callosum and asymmetry of cortical spinal tract. Some words about the mental recovery stage of the and the brain plasticity. It's a scheme which was performed with our colleagues in the Burdenka, which shows how the patient go out from the comatose state to vegetative state, to minimally consciousness state, and so on. And let me show the real clinical situation. In this picture, some clinical stage of recovery process in 23-year-old girl with TBI after traffic accident. She was in comatose state, and on CT, we could see very small hemorrhage in the brainstem. She was in comatose state with left side hemiparesis. Next step, 16 days, you see, in five months, first steps, and in 6 years after trauma, social adaptation, and how it looks here, connectome. You see, in 6 years, it was a real recovery process. In our series, we analyzed 90 patients during long time tractography, and only 3 of these patients had real recovery process. Let me show these 3 cases. This is a lady, you see, she had a traffic accident also. They developed the hemiparesis with asymmetry of cortical spinal tract in 3 months, but in 10 months, in 13 months, and in 2 years, regression of left side hemiparesis. And it is the recovery of cortical spinal tract. It is the plasticity of the brain. And this data permit us to conceptualize that diffuse axonal injury is a clinical model of multidimensional split the brain disease. And what is the condition for nervous system regeneration? You could see how complex this situation is. We need to restore the blood flow, CSF circulation, and as many other things for recovery of the brain fibers and brain tissue. But now we can get some use some modern neuroimaging technique to visualize different signs of the secondary damage, like a cerebral edema, disturbance of the cerebral blood flow, and so on. Diffusion weighted imaging allows us to differentiate cytotoxic or vasogenic edema based on apparent diffusion coefficient. This case shows typical cytotoxic edema in corpus callosum. You see here the quantitative data. The higher diffusion coefficient indicates perifocal vasogenic edema in case of multifocal contusion, like here. But a CT perfusion study shows that ischemia in the core of the contusion may accompany with some sort of hyperemia and disturbance of the cerebral blood flow. Our data shows that we can see the different patterns of disturbance of the blood flow in area of contusion from in other side of hemisphere. And not only ischemia, but also the hyperemia in 10% of patients may be the reason of serious damage of the brain. You see the patient after removal of subdural hematoma, nothing, a little bit decreased the CT density. You see the DVI, which show us the some edema, but using the CT perfusion, we see high regional hyperemia. What is the result of this malignant hyperemia? You see, we perform this study in dynamic. In 1.5 months, in 7 months, in 18 months, she had the diffuse cystic atrophy in this region because of the malignant hyperemia. That means that not only ischemia, but malignant hyperemia is one of the bad prognostic factors. In all previous publications, CT perfusion studies of CBF were performed in hemispheric structures mostly. Preliminary analysis reveals that the brainstem blood flow in patients with mild head injury, you see here, is in more narrow limits than in comatose state. Let me show the brainstem pattern in primary brain injury. You see how critical level is blood flow in the brainstem. But in patients with non-hemorrhagic lesion of brainstem, the blood flow level never decreased so low levels. But our analysis, when we use the parallel CT perfusion and pressure reactivity index studies, it permits us to see that the level of blood flow depends not only primary or secondary brainstem lesion, but on the condition of the autoregulation of the cerebral blood flow. These data were supported by Russian Foundation for Basic Research and were published in Springer last year. And finally, let me tell you some words about neuroimaging future. There are two main models for diffusion-weighted MRI, Gaussian models and non-Gaussian models. And now, when we use diffusion kurtosis, we could see how many new tissue brain parameters we can analyze. For clinicians, it's difficult to understand what does it mean. What is the clinical effect of this complex study? But we can now to get new information about axonal water fraction in each part of the brain. We can see it in dynamic, like here, the patient with the injury of the thalamus corpus callosum on admission, and 50 days ago, you see the effect of our treatment process. Now appeared new Hardy method, which permit to see the connectome of the human brain in dynamic with different kind of injury. And of course, now the new data can give us not only 2D, but 4D imaging of the brain with blood circulation, functional MRI, and so on. And finally, I would say that modern neuroimaging techniques provide new knowledge about basic anatomy and pathophysiology of brain trauma, brain plasticity, thus optimizing treatment algorithm and prognostic model. Development of novel modalities open up new horizons for clinical studies and basic neuroscience. And this book has been written by Marco Catani and Stefano Sandroni this year to mark the birth of the remarkable anatomist Andreas Vesalius in Brussels 5 centuries year ago. The beginning of 21st century is a real time for brain renaissance and neuroscience. And finally, I would like to thank Professor President of the Academy, Zach Broci, for kindly invitation, and it is a great honor for me that here I am a lecture with two World Federation President, Professor Broci and Professor Armando Basler. It's a great honor for me. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Potapov. Now I open the discussion. Yes, please.
An emerging problem of TBI is that survivors have the worst quality of life. And one problem that is
known is that there are neuroendocrine consequences, neuroendocrine problems about TBIs. According to your experience and the literature, what will you expect about new radiological techniques in, for example, visualizing hypothalamic or pituitary lesions?
Thank you for your question. It's a very important question. I think that MRI compared with CT permit us to see real anatomy. It depends on what kind of modalities we can use. In one case, it's necessary to use tissue modalities. In another one, MRI spectroscopy. In other one, MRI perfusion or CT perfusion, and it depends on the type of injury and the clinical stage and clinical situation. If you can understand from CT data and explain why the patient is in comatose state in this serious situation, it's enough. But if you cannot understand why the patient has so serious condition, so deep neurological deficit, hemiparesis, and so on, you have to perform the MRI. But MRI has some limitation, not only indication, but some limitation, because it's a long way study comparing with CT. Thank you.
Another question? Yeah. Bernard Dan.
Thank you very much, Professor Potapov. I'd like to ask two questions. The first relates to plasticity. You showed us factors that might influence the emergence of plasticity. I was wondering how important the age of the patient is for a potential for recovery. The other question is, I would like to know if you could suggest indications for this intriguing stimulation technique, spinal cord stimulation technique that led your patient from PVS to MCS.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let me answer the last question. Because 20 years ago, 30 years ago, there were many enthusiastic neurosurgeons to use this neuromodulation. From Japan, in Japan, in Europe countries, in Russia, in other countries, in Brazil, and so on. But up to now, it's clear that when we stimulate the cervical column or tip brain structure, we can activate the hemisphere. But we can influence on the blood flow because we increase the brain activity. We can influence on metabolism, but we cannot be sure that we can transform the minimal consciousness state to full consciousness. And that's why but it is an invasive technique. Later on appeared another kind of technique, transcortical magnetic stimulation, peripheral nerve stimulation, and now it's clear that there is no any one modality which permit to answer all questions. In one case, it's necessary to normalize the blood flow, cerebral perfusion pressure, level of the osmotic pressure of the blood, normalize the temperature and so on, and it will be the spontaneous biological process of recovery. And from the other side, if the patient still now is in vegetative state, we have to use all afferent stimuli for the brain. TV, sound, music, peripheral nerve stimulation, and later on only the deep brain stimulation. Because the biggest experience has Japanese colleagues, Kano, Professor Kano, and Professor Tsubakawa, he is dead now, and he was my co-worker in this technology. And I think that this approach has some future, but now we have no final answers. And the first question is concerning... Yeah, it's an absolutely fundamental question. Let me say you that in 2006, it was a fantastic publication in Science. The title of publication was MRI spectroscopy permits to identify the brainstem in the adult human brain. It was published by Manganas and co-workers. They use a very complex MRI spectroscopy. And they identify the real brainstem in young people, normal young people, but not in age, in old people. But after that, nobody could repeat this study. Till now, we couldn't answer what is the limit of the neurogenesis. But we know that all of people, all age, has some neurogenetic process, but genesis. But we don't know how to identify now. Thank you.
Oui.
Thank you for your presentation. In your studies, did you have informed consent of the patients? And if so, how is this possible if they were in a coma?
Very good question. Of course, we have an ethic committee. We have as a committee of our institution, and we perform any study after informed consent. But you see, if the patient come in comatose state, we should get this permission from relatives. We explain that it could help us to understand the process, the real disease. If they write that they agree, after that we perform this MRI study. Because MRI doesn't include it in the standard guidelines. It's a very complex study.
Is there another question? If I have a small question. About plasticity, what you have nicely shown with the plasticity of the pyramidal tract on the tractography on the MRI. My question is, what is improving first, the patient or the MRI? It means, can we guess with the MRI before that the patient will improve? Is it a prognosis index, or do you see improving of the patient and at the same time you see improving of the tractography and pyramidal tract?
Thank you. Thank you. It's a very good question. Of course, we could see the clinical stages every day, but we could perform the MRI not every day. That's why we couldn't use the MRI as monitoring method only one in a 3 year, 3 months, 6 months, and so on. But sometimes we see the early signs of recovery of the tracts. And we, if the patient use any sedative drugs or anti-epileptic drugs with sedative effect, when we close this treatment, we could see that the patient, in if we see the real on MRI recovery of the tract, we see the next step increasing the clinically improving the movement in paretic arm or leg. But it's a good question how to use in prognostic, for prognosis, this data. Thank you.
Thank you. So, thank you very much for your very high level lecture. And thank you again for coming to Brussels. Thank you.
Thank you.